Thank you, Bronwyn. I would just ask as well that be aware of your mobile phones. If you haven't turned them off, it may be a good idea to do that. The other thing is then to begin this in conversation with two people who really are neither moderate nor need moderating. We have a piece or two pieces of music, which this could also be called the center for the left field. When we were doing a sound test this morning, William and Sam both said, well, here's our choice of music for the beginning. And William said, why not play them both at once? And everybody was, the sound crew and Sam were together. And he said, well, let the one sound come up and the other go down. So for those of you who thought that the Miles Davis was sounding a little different, that's because Paul Hindemith, an early 20th century composer, comes in between or alongside. And the amazing thing is that, like the less good idea that the center stands for, the brilliance of it, when you hear these two pieces of music, modernist and jazz, really intended from two very different fields, they sound and have been sounding while you were sitting here as though they could have been one piece. And beyond that, it's just to say that I have two people born October and April 1955, two South African artists who have built great reputations, who don't need my billing them, but who we want to actually hear something about two very different growing experiences in the South Africa that is represented over the 60-something years of our lives. And so I want to start by asking both of you something about very first memories and something about the grandmother. You had a grandmother who was an attorney at an unusual time of life. You had a grandmother who was weaving grass baskets and trading them for secondhand clothing to help you help her raise you. Tell us about your grandmother.
Well, I had two grandmothers. And the one my mother's mother had indeed been an advocate, the first woman advocate in South Africa. But by the time I was growing up, she was a grandmother. She was no longer a lawyer. But my other grandmother used to do weaving. And she didn't weave baskets, she wove bedspreads. But the sense of being taken at an early age to the technical college in Box Street, I think, where they had a series of looms, and she would be weaving her tablecloths and bedspreads. So there's a weaving ancestry there.
Okay, I had one grandmother from my mother's side who'd weave those baskets, and at the same time would also do buy chairs that were made out of wood, and then I would help her to paint those chairs. Kids' chairs with small round tables. And I used to walk a lot of kilometers. The other day, I think 4 or 5 years ago, I drove with my wife and I showed her, I said, this is the distance that we used to take with my grandmother. Because at the same time, I felt that I was protecting her. But truly speaking, if something could have happened to her, I wouldn't have done anything. Probably I would just like scare whoever was attacking, because I was this tiny little boy. So yeah, but I always hear stories that kids who grow up under their grandparents, they are so spoiled. Not with my grandmother. Because she would throw a clap on me.
And where was this?
This was in the 60s. In fact, I from the family of eight, me and my eldest brother, who was a jazz musician, he was brought up by my grandfather, who was my mother's uncle. And I, at the age of 9 months, I was taken to my grandma to Heidelberg. So, and interestingly so, among the eight, we were the only two that were independent and focused. All my siblings, I'm glad they're not here, but they're not focused.
And Those were really early influences, but we've been talking over the last couple of days, and you were thinking of the stakes in the ground, the times, those first memories, things that made you aware of, I'm here in South Africa. You spoke about Sharpeville. Do you know where you were when you remember hearing that? And what was the impression that came to you?
One of my, because like...
We were five. How old were we? Five, six?
Five, six. Five yeah. and a half.
Yeah. Five and a half.
Yeah. And because we're like a family. The first house was my grandma's nephew. And then it was my grandma's house, and it was my uncle's house. And then, like, she was hanging. My grandma's niece was hanging on the fence, said, news on the radio, so many people have died in Sharpeville. And then it was, like, spreading around. We were young, playing soccer, but we could see. I mean, like, in the neighborhood, everybody was concerned. Later, I remember the radio at the house was a pilot. Everybody was sitting next to the pilot. And then the news broke up that people were shot. And then the next day, I think it was World or Post, not Sowetan, World or Post, pictures of bodies lying around. I was 5.5 years.
So, I mean, those photos are astonishing how they sit in one's head. I had a different, I have no memory of the day of the Sharpeville shooting, but it would have been, I suppose, several months later when they had the inquest into it, when I must have been 6 years old. And my father was one of the lawyers for the representing the families of the people killed at the inquest into the shooting. And I went one evening into his study where there was this yellow box that looked like a box of chocolates, a glossy box. And I thought, well, breaking the rules, I was going to open it and take out a chocolate. But instead of chocolates, what was in were those photos you'd seen in the paper. The 8x10 glossy black and white photos of people who'd been shot and their backs blown up and the whole horror story that was there. And that for me was a moment of understanding how different the world is, the violence of adults in a very... One was used to children fighting, but one hadn't really been so aware of it, of adults in that form. And I guiltily quickly put the lid on the chocolate box and put it back on the shelf so no one would know I'd seen it, feeling guilty for having, both I think for having, thinking I could take a chocolate, but also for having seen those images. Even at that age, there was a sense of one shouldn't see those. And in fact, many, many years later, I had a conversation a bit like this with my father. And I told the same story, or this came out about the memories of Sharpeville. And he said he had one thing to add, because I'd spoken, he'd known of the story before, and he said, he wanted to make an apology to me. I said, what have you got to apologize for? But he said he wanted to apologize for having left the photos where a six-year-old could find them. And that was a new thought for me. But anyway, that was Sharpeville and Sharpeville.
And you both have spoken before about people like Harold Rubin and Dumile, who made work immediately in response to Sharpeville that both of you later became aware of and saw as people of influence in both a style of drawing and a style of representation of what was happening in your own histories?
Well, for me, I discovered Dumile, I think, in the mid-70s. You remember there was in Commissioner Street, not far from Colosseum, American Library. That's where we used to go.
USIS, American Information Service.
Yes, yeah. That's where we go and sit there and find information about various things. But even Dumile, I discovered Dumile at that time. I discovered our neighbor, Lucas Itole, the sculptor, who was, his house was three streets away from my parents' house. And and I think Sikoto Patli, the yellow house. So those are some of my early images of those artists' works.
So Dumile is an interesting person because I met him when he was living in the house of Bill Ainslie, who we both later had a connection to, which I'm sure we'll talk about later. But in the late 1960s, Dumile Fanny was living and working in the room at Bill Ainslie's house, and Bill Ainslie and his wife Fika had come and house sat and babysat my sisters and my brother and myself when my parents were overseas. So that was in 1968 when I was 13. And after that, when he'd gone back, they became family friends, the Ainslies and my parents. And I went to visit them, and there was Dumili working. It was a small room which had a bed on one side. Pinned to the wall were these large, quite demonic charcoal drawings of the train crash, of goats of different, in this extraordinary fine charcoal, very worked way. And in the middle of the floor, so the bed was there, maybe 2 foot from the bed, going almost to the ceiling, was this really rough clay sculpture that was being made. So it would be like you'd have to go around it to climb into the bed and go sideways around it to work on the drawings. And then he emigrated. So I think he emigrated when I was about 14 or 15. So I was not aware of him as a student. But when I came back to making drawings many years later, I realized that what was sitting in my head was some of those very early images from 14. But I also want to know about when you were younger, as a child, what were the sort of images in your house? What were the images around you? I presume there was not a library full of art books.
But there's an interesting point that you made earlier today about your beginnings with collage. And that featured Sam's guilty secret with his grandmother when she wanted him to go selling clothes with her, and he ran away to try out for a soccer team. And when he saw Granny walking in the field, his conscience got the better of him, and he gave up the idea of playing soccer to go and work with Granny. But you spoke then about the earliest beginnings of collage as an idea for you, as an Orlando Pirates fan.
Yeah, my uncle, who was third from my mother, used to buy newspapers all the time. But I remember Mondays and weekends, especially if Pirates was playing on Saturday, he would definitely make sure that he buys a paper, if only Pirates has won. So I used to sort of like, he saw me cutting out and putting these pages, but I was recycling some of our old exercise books and sticking them onto my exercise book. And
then I was pictures of soccer pictures?
Yes. Okay. And
so not thinking of them as art? Thinking of them as soccer?
Yes, because I also loved Pirates. But the irony was, I mean, there was no glue. The only thing that I could do was just like to look around, no one sees me, and then from the bowl of sugar, I'll just do this, put it into water, mix it. That was my glue. So, and Neil asked me, did you keep those? I said, you know, not long ago, my cousin asked me, those could have been like very strong history of Sam during that time, because you're using collage now, and then you started when you were about 6, 7, 8, but I didn't know that I would be an artist.
But you drew from an early age as well, as did Sam.
Yep.
Yeah, I mean, I think that all children, or almost all children, draw. I have a grandson who resolutely refuses to put a pencil in his hand and would much rather play a piano than do any drawing. But in general, most children draw.
Yeah, it's true.
And I think what one could say about Sam and I both is that we just forgot to stop. And that you find that children draw, and then at about 8 or 10, there's a change, and then they're little miniature figures, and then the whole war scenes that are done, and then when you're 15, it's copying comics and things, well, in my case, of those kinds of things. And then people kind of grow up, and they become rational beings, and that's put aside. But, I mean, I was happy to go, to art lessons from about the age of 8, I think. And what drawings were they encouraged? Were you?
Well, I used to I think standard 4, 5, 6. I used to decorate my books, you know, the covers. I remember we used to use brown cover. I used to sort of like draw that. And then some of my classmates were fascinated by that. And then I would like go home with a pile of books, and then please do this for me. And I started to make money at an early age because I was paid half a penny for illustrating one exercise book. So that was that time. And then 1968, when was it 68 when Percy Sledge was here?
Percy Sledge was here in later. Percy Sledge was here in...
End of 69.
69.
Percy Sledge and Stella Star tour that we spoke about.
Yeah.
I went to hear Percy Sledge in the Colosseum.
Yes, he came to Colosseum, and then I was doing my standard six, and then the front page of World had him with that afro.
Big hat of the afro, yes.
Yes, and then I drew him, and then like... And then everybody was like saying, oh, you're so good. And then I even got, when I was doing standard six, I got a nickname of Percy Sledge.
But I think an interesting thing there for me is that, because I can also find the same route very early on, is that a lot of people, you have to find something that you are good at through which you can kind of earn people's respect, whether it's at school or family or people like that. And I think for me, a vital part was that early on, as with you, there was a way of either making things or doing drawings that got a kind of strong sense of approval from other people and people seeing you in a different way. And I'm sure that that kind of early psychic connection between what it is to make a drawing or to make a work of art and the response that you get to yourself via the work that you have made is still one of the engines, certainly, I'm sure, inside of me, but I'm sure inside of most...
Well, the thing is, like, one of the things that I remember about you was, I think it was 76 at the Art Foundation. You used to sit there doing your portrait, and then with those grids, like, squares, that are, and then we're all skinny with afros. And but it was just like... William is a student here, so-and-so is a student. But like, no one had a sense that one day we'll be here, we'll be sort of like sharing common spaces within our profession. So, but that I remember very well under Bill Ainslie.
I mean, it was, I mean, we should get maybe onto the Art Foundation. Maybe before that though, because we've done Sharpeville, but maybe what about the other
1968 is the date that has come up now on a few occasions, and we spoke briefly about the significance of that tour with Robert Kennedy in South Africa and his assassination, but also the death of Martin Luther King in 1968.
And
there
we
is something
13.
In that power, at 13, the power of taboo in terms of subject and what became fixed images and things that became subjects for your own drawing. Have you got a specific memory? You spoke particularly about 68 before.
Well, 68, there are... 68, I remember strongly thinking, I've been born at the wrong time, I've been born at the wrong place. If only I'd been born 5 years earlier and in Berkeley in America or in Paris or in Berlin, I could have been part of the student protests, I could have been part of a kind of history, but here in suburban Johannesburg, that seemed immensely far away. Because it was. There was newspaper articles about the Vietnam War. There was the news of the Kennedy assassination, of Robert Kennedy and of Martin Luther King, of cities burning in the United States, and it felt, oh, that's where history is happening. And of course, 8 years later, in 76, it all came here very strongly. But I don't know, your memories of 68, were you?
Well, yes, Martin Luther King, and before Sharpeville. But I could see that the Martin Luther King, it instilled more fears to the black people in Heidelberg. Because like I was just like centered around that place, that it's a warning that we did the Sharpeville thing. And now a powerful man has been assassinated. So there was that quietness. And people who were like active, they went into exile.
And in 68?
In 68. I mean, like there were people that were just, because then there was, it was not right that so-and-so will disappear and then maybe he or she's dead. But people went as if they went to study. I mean, if you think of how many musicians left, including Huma Sigela, the King Kong, all those guys left, Dumile, but and that group of Chris McGregor. That to me was like my, because I remember my uncle had an album of their 1964 performance in Orlando. Chris McGregor and his band, they all left to London and they never came back. One member who's surviving, Louis Moholo, is back. He's in Cape Town.
It's interesting that you talk about the exile group, because there is a postscript to this conversation which will bring in Harry Belafonte and Miriam Makeba at the end of this conversation. And there are meetings and beginnings in things in the music world that you eventually became probably one of South Africa's best commentators on, and certainly a man who always has followed how much jazz tracked the visual history of our times. But William, also music became for you something really significant in your family's house in these same times of growing up. What was the first thing you thought about in terms of a musical score or a piece of music that related to the images that you yourself wanted to make?
I mean, I think in some ways there was interesting music being played in the house when I grew up. Gramophone records that my father had. I had very, very predictable, conservative, unimaginative tastes. Whatever was being played at school, I'd be listening to. And it was, as we had at the age of five, are you Cliff Richards or Elvis Presley? And later on, are you the Beatles or are you the Rolling Stones? And I always had the uncool choice. But there were interesting other pieces of music. I don't know if we should play some of the music now. Maybe the piece of Shostakovich we could play a bit.
So, yeah. Which one? And so William has the Shostakovich choice, and you have a sort of counterpoint musically to that. So perhaps we'll have an interlude from Shostakovich, and then we'll go on to Keith Jarrett.
Okay, so this Shostakovich piece I must have first heard when I was 14, when this is an old record from my father's record collection. But there was something about the energy in this last movement of the first piano concerto of Shostakovich that kind of gave me an astonishing visceral energy. And in fact, so much so that I used it 30 years later in the soundtrack in one of the animated films. And then 10 years later after that, came back to look closely at Shostakovich doing a production of The Nose. But I would say this was an early piece that was a surprise, because I'd never heard anything quite like it. We just listened to 2 minutes of it, maybe the last 2 minutes. I think you've got it on the wrong side. Yeah. That's the second concerto, I think.
And when was this, William?
This would have been in the late 60s that I would have heard it.
Okay, because with me it was, I was 15 years, 1970, with Dave Brubeck and Kind of Blue, I mean, Take Five and Kind of Blue.
And that was when you started listening to that music and discovered it. And had other, but you had a jazz musician in your family.
My eldest brother was, he played three instruments. He played the flugelhorn, he played the flute, and then he also played a piano.
Okay, so let's listen. Yeah, this he wrote when he was a student. This is a very early piece. Thank you. Okay, so that was...
With this kind of music, I remember my brother sometimes, he would sort of like play this in the background and come in with his flute. And then I would pretend to be the conductor. Please.
Not what one would call prosaic music for the boy who said also he had being the conventional taste.
No, but being a conductor, when I was 15 at school, somebody said, what do you want to be when you grow up? And said, oh, I wanted to be a conductor of opera. And then they said, because I was so good at conducting gramophone records with a chopstick, like the baton. And I said, I wanted to be a conductor. They said, oh, but you know, you have to be able to read music to be a conductor. And I said, you do? Oh, okay, we'd better change that plan. But there is something about hearing the music and the energy that gets you inside your body, which still feels the same.
Yep.
It doesn't feel different. That it's not just something you're hearing. It's your whole body responds to it. Obviously, with certain music, you can feel it in the way one immediately starts to dance. But even with music that's not for dance, there's a kind of a gift of energy that you're ready to... Everything seems kind of possible for that moment till the music comes to the end.
And we'll go to the Brubeck take five. Next, please.
Talk about that.
Sam, I think that, you know, nobody else can tell the story like you. It's interesting that your brother listened to classical music, but also was immediately infected with the desire to become a jazz musician. And you were the one who took the initiative to make things right on his wedding day.
No, this is now the second brother.
Ah, the second brother.
That's
okay.
The one who was getting married.
But I think you have to tell the story of the wedding.
Well, my brother was like in and out, preparing and then like looking at his tie because it was his big day wedding. And what do you call them?
The retinue.
Yeah.
The groomsmen.
Yes, they were around there, but I could see that everybody's a bit, you know, nervous. And then I took my brother's favorite albums back to back, Johnny Hodges and Duke Ellington, Dave Brubeck, Paul Desmond, and Miles Davis. I put them there. I opened up his record player. I started to play music. I remember one guy was tapping. And then I lifted their spirit. Everybody was just like, now, okay. And I said, well, I'm a good DJ.
And the rest is history.
The rest is history.
Shall we have take five? I said to Sam today, it seems a really good idea when you're trying to say to people, just chill out, hold on a minute. Take five is a pretty good choice.
A bit brutal.
Somehow it seems a sin to have to cut that off. But I think that should bring us then to both the facts that you both have made works with titles and with portraits of composers at different stages. But the next great date that crops up is the year in which you both met, and you both met at the Art Foundation in 1976, partly because of the crisis in the country, and particularly the crisis in township schools, where for some 18 months or so, Sam couldn't go to school because it wasn't safe. And the police were manning the streets outside the township schools. And a friend got him into a course with Bill Ainslie, who he had heard of, and he enrolled himself into the Johannesburg Art Foundation. And I think that perhaps you should start telling us just a little about how that came to be and how the two of you then met with Bill.
That was because, like, every day we'd go to school and army trucks would be there, police would be there, and then, like, we'd sit there without doing anything. What's the purpose? And I said, I need to be educated. I need something. And then a friend of mine, Mafangwenya, said, there's a school called Rocksdrift in Natal, apply. And I applied. I said, in the meantime, I think it was August, September, in the meantime, what am I doing? And then I found out from FUBA about the Art Foundation. And then I went and I started my lessons. I was very happy. And then William was there, Ricky Bennett, Gail Trebler.
Gail Berman.
Gail Berman.
Ilona.
Yes. And who was...
Walter Neustadter.
Yes. And then who... what's her first name? Sassoon?
Anne Sassoon. Yeah.
So that group. And should I stop there or continue?
Well, okay. So my connection to... Well, as I said, Bill came and met the Ainslie family when they were looking after us. And then when I was about 15, my mother started going for drawing lessons. And then I accompanied her at 15. And the first 20 minutes was awkward for a 15-year-old boy to be confronted with a naked woman that you were meant to be drawing as if it was a vase of flowers, when a 15-year-old boy does not see a naked woman like a vase of flowers. And you don't know where to look. And then you say, no, I'm just an artist. I can't, what am I meant to be doing here? And thank God she's put on her gown now. Okay. But won't she take it off again? Okay, she's taking it off. Now I'm meant to be drawing. But it was astonishing how in the second lesson it's naturalized. No, there's a model, one that's doing it. It's, anyway, so that was the route into the Art Foundation as a part-time student and later when I finished at university as a full-time student. Well, so in 76, I was mainly there. I was still at Wits a bit,
but
I was mainly at the Art Foundation.
Well, talking about that, because my mother was worried because my moves were so secretive to her because she never supported anything to do with the arts. She thought I'll be safe because there are riots, stay at home, but I didn't want to stay at home. And then I said, now I'm attending art lessons. She looked at me. One day she was cleaning our rooms, which were adjacent with my brother's. And then she saw some plastic bag with my sketchbook. She went through and she saw a drawing of a naked woman. And she said, is this what they are teaching you? So nudes, I mean,
And meantime, you were training and busing and getting across a lot of Strafford, Johannesburg to be able to get to those lessons.
Well, yeah, I mean, take a taxi to the station, from Guatemala to Springs, a train to Park Station, that from nowhere, sometimes the train will just stop and we don't know what's the problem. But I would say my journey from Park Station to the Art Foundation, I would be talking slightly over 2 hours. And you were neighbors with Bill, I mean. You were just
your
around
neighbors. No, I mean, there's the unbelievable difference of what it is to be living in the suburbs where it's a 5-minute drive from home to the Art Foundation and back. And I mean, it's an astonishing thing, those different conditions of privilege that were there and which we know still continue in many ways.
And I think it was so stressful for Bill from some of us who were coming from the townships, because sometimes around 8, Bill will get a call that, Bill, I've been arrested. And sometimes you wouldn't reach home, you'll sleep somewhere in the police station. And that didn't sort of broke our spirits about who do we want to be. I mean, if at all one was the system was just gonna hit me so hard, I would have quit. But I said, this is what I want, I'll pursue it. And when I tell people that the first time I defied my mother, it's when I said I want to do art.
And what would she have liked you to have done?
Well, it would be like the whole neighborhood. There were teachers, there were clerks of companies. Can't you see Mr. So-and-so's child is doing this? I said, but I'm not like them. This is what I want. And then the argument went on and on. And when I was accepted at Rockstrift, and as put my trunk there. I think these youngsters don't know that. We used to carry a very still, heavy trunk to put our things. And then it was there. And then my mother said, really, you're going? And then my brother came and said, she said to my brother, you also knew about him leaving the house, going to Natal. And said, he asked for a lift. And then my mother said, okay, I'm coming. My mother left to our neighbor opposite. She came with Mrs. Mbonani. And then she said to me, let us pray. but it was such an emotional 10-hour trip or more from Springs to Dundee because I was like thinking about my mother. So, but yeah, at the end of the day, she didn't want me to tell people that she didn't want me to do art.
But that led to your second playing truant and not telling your mother, because one of, I'm going to ask you about a guilty secret, but Sam's best guilty secret that I never had heard from anybody before is that I think you could be the only person who ever got expelled from Rorkestrift.
Yeah, this is the first time I'm telling the public about this. And what happened is like there would be a 3-month probation, and then they'll assess you and they will simply tell you that you won't make it. So Ida, who was the wife to Jules van der Riva, twice, he found me in front of the class, like dancing, you know, doing all that. And she said to me, you know, you don't belong here. You must go to a drama school.
I like the fact that at that time, there were Jules and Ida van der Vever visiting Dutch lecturers. And Ida was saying, no, Sam, give up on the art side. You should be at the drama school. William was really studying theatre at the university at the time. And I remember going to the Art Foundation the first time I went to some lessons there. Bill said to me, yeah, you know, there's some good people drawing in this class. But, you know, well, William draws. He can draw, but he's really looking at theatre. You know, he's not really trying to draw properly. So don't look at that. And Tony and Kotze, he used to say to me as well, don't look at Tony. Tony thinks he's going to have a career in advertising. And you've just left advertising, so, you know, you must learn to draw. I have to tell you that the conversation we had at lunch today, the naked woman story in the class was never easy. Nobody I could think of in those classes, apart from the lecturers, felt comfortable when the lady in question, whoever she might be, disrobed and sat down for people to start drawing her. But even worse was when Bill came around and looked at your drawing and said, no, you haven't got that curve right, and there's a shape here that's missing, and you should start that all over again. And you thought, oh, my God, do I really have to? But you were, what happened in terms of that period? Because you went from your theatre studies and working to your next Less Good Idea, you decided you were going to design and direct theatre.
Well, just first to talk a bit about the Art Foundation, which was, it was interesting. On the one hand, it was a very bad school, but maybe because of it, it was the less good school. It was actually a very good school. It wasn't good at teaching you the correct way to apply oil paint. What was the 500-year history of doing a glaze and a gesso ground and those things? So that for me, oil painting became kind of impossible. I didn't know how to deal with the material. But it had an interesting push that Bill Ainslie was someone who painted with color field abstraction, first in oil, then in acrylics. And that was the kind of the house style of the foundation, apart from these portraits and life drawing classes. But he gave an interesting challenge to the students, I remember, in 1976, to the group that I was with. And he said, why is it that in South Africa at that time, only black artists were drawing the figure, not as exercises, but in their work? And he said, all right, if you're not happy with this abstract color field work, go and draw the world, go and draw people, go and draw figures. And that became kind of the spur to take that as a challenge, to say there should be a way of making art that is not abstract color field painting, which I was so bad at. And I think maybe it's then when I remembered, oh, I had in fact seen someone who made large-scale charcoal drawings who was Dumili. And I think he also, some of the pictures that were brought in with like images of Romeo Bearden, that must have also been important for you when you were there.
Yeah, because I started to do collage even before I went to Rorkestrift. And then I had a moment with Bill to show him. There were about 5 A4 size collages. And then he asked me a question, do you know Romeo Bearden? I said, no, who's that? He said, okay, do more exercises and come, and then let's discuss that. And then I was so inquisitive, and then went back home, and then like, over a week's time, and then I had about 12. And then we sat in that lounge of his where we used to have tea, and then he pulled this book of Romeo Bearden. And I said, no, I don't know this guy. And then he said, go through it. And that was the first time I was introduced to this African-American collagist who inspired me. I was introduced to him by Bill Ainslie. That was 1976.
I think we could maybe have a quick piece of that, Keith Jarrett. I do remember you saying to me when I first asked you why collage, and I'm talking about in the 1980s, when you were still showing, I think, with Ranolt Kassira, why had you moved from these big, big, big abstract paintings like the Johannesburg Art Gallery had bought, and drawings I'd seen in either sketchbooks at the foundation or in Kassira Fine Art. And you both had ended up working with this dealer, having found your way through different elements of your careers, but you said straight away, the best thing Bill did for me was to introduce me to Romare Bearden, and then the discovery that people like Louis Armstrong and Miles Davis, who held your imagination and your emotion musically in their hands, but they all made collage. And you saw that music and your collage and these collages of pastiche, things layered one upon the other. Can we have a minute or two of the Jarrett? God bless the child who has his own. It's an emotional title for you, I know.
Yeah, this, earlier on, William said something about the music gets into you. I mean, I can just share this with the audience that when I play this painting, I mean, the movements that I do there, it's like, I feel it, you know, it's so soulful and I feel good.
But now you're talking about literal movements, because one does have ridiculous movements in the studio.
Well,
when you're playing it, you feel it.
I'm all by myself. The big canvas is there, and I sort of like move.
No, but I think one does, because you need to feel the relationship to the canvas or the drawing in your body, how you shift in relation to it.
Yeah, that's exactly what happens. So especially that particular track.
William always said the studio is the place to pace, to experiment, to be on your own and maybe drawing yourself, because maybe you don't want somebody else hanging around while you're making those movements.
No, but in relation to that sort of movement, that strange dance before a canvas or a painting, it's the section which I talk about, the studio as a safe space for stupidity. Where if somebody else is watching you, they think, what on earth is going on? But it's actually a necessary part. And, I mean, music is for me, music in the studio works in two ways. Sometimes it's about a specific energy and listening to a piece of music. Sometimes it works just as a barrier to make a kind of wall of sound so I don't hear other things and can get on with work, which is very bad listening.
There's a track of Charles Mingus, who's a popular acoustic bass player. There's an album of his where he plays piano, and the title is Myself When I'm Real. So probably when I do all those things, I'm real, and I know there's no one except the flies and the mosquitoes.
So there's a great thought, actually, that we can all take away from this, is that if any of us have ambitions in the same directions, paint like nobody's watching, draw like nobody's watching, and dance like nobody's watching. I think we need to wrap up fairly soon, so I'm going to ask each of you to speak of a defining moment. You've both talked about having a public conversation before. You've both talked about how many things there were in your interest in music, in theater, in drama. You've both been generous with your peers. You've collaborated with everybody from tapestry weaving to printmakers, people like Mark Atwood and Jill Roberts and Kim Berman. And you've left a great legacy behind both of you already, as young men only 6 decades into what we're sure will be long lives, what would be the best moment for you looking back? And William, maybe let's start with you on that one.
No, that's impossible. Start with Sam.
Okay, pick a moment or two.
Well, it's been under Mr. Rhino Kasire, because I think that gentleman shaped us. We are rookies. I mean, then no one knew about William, Sam, Carol Nell, etc. But he was such a good dealer. And then when he closed his gallery, we all went under Linda Goodman at Hyde Park. Mm-hmm. And we're still with Goodman Gallery. So yeah, those are some of the highlights. And like, you know, to touch base with some of the things that happened between the two of us on different times, is that you were a set designer earlier than I joined the SABC, and then I was a set designer as well. And then we both won the Standard Bank Award differently. And we've been traveling this path together, coming from you coming from the West, I coming from the East. But yeah, we're still here.
Yeah. I mean, I would say that the great moments are the moments when that energy, like the energy from the music, is in one, in the studio, and you know you're onto something that's being made. But I would agree with you with that, also with that early period with Reinhold Kassira. This is, he had a small gallery in Rosebank, not for many years. He mainly dealt with German secondary expressionist prints and drawings. So it was very nice to be hanging next to a Max Liebermann or an Eric Nolde or something like that, which is where the work was seen. But I suppose it would have both been in those exhibitions that we had the sense of, okay, this is possible. This is not impossible. There's a picture on the wall that's framed. And not only that, this has got, if not measles, at least it's got acne, different red dots in different parts of the gallery, and it's not an impossible undertaking. And that's kind of a fantastic feeling as a young artist.
And can I ask you a question, William? How does it feel to, especially now that Mark left to Mpumalanga, just to sort of like vacate your space and go drive thinking about the prints that you'll be doing? How does it still work for you?
So this is about going to print studios, not in the, I mean, I work a lot with Lungisi across, right across the way here, and with Jill Ross and David Krut, print studio 5 meters from my studio, and that is kind of easy. I love working with Mark Atwood, who's in White River, who's one of the great, great printmakers, master printers of the world. There are things he can do that no other printer I've worked with in any studio anywhere can do. It's sometimes difficult to travel that distance and know that suddenly you have to produce all the prints in that space rather than in a different rhythm that you would have in the studio. But it's always worth the journey.
Well, it's worth the journey. To me, it's a nice break, like shifting from this medium that I use in my studio, thinking about now I'm going to be locked in White River for 2 weeks. And because I use more color with him, thinking about sometimes with sort of like one print would use about 12 different plates. So can you imagine if we, on average, we're doing probably 7, and then I'm doing a series of 5. So many plates. And the other part that I would say it's really tiresome, it's when you have to sign that edition. Because at the end, your wrist, it's like, it's done. But it's fun. And Deborah is here as well. She knows that experience of working with
Mark. This for me is, it's a particularly South African thing amongst artists, is the number of artists for whom printmaking has been central to their activity, not a thing at the edges, but what they've been, you know, that becomes an important part of thinking about making an image. Not that one's done a painting and then one does a print, one's done a drawing and then one, but that it's actually thinking. And I'm sure Rorke's Drift is important. Rorke's Drift is very important in that, in the...
We should mention that even though you got expelled, you were actually brought back.
Yeah.
And that the students threatened to riot in order to get him back.
I got a call Bill got a call from Jules saying, I understand Sam is there with you. And then he said, yeah, he's here. And he said, can you persuade Sam to come back? And I said to Bill, no, Bill, I'm happy here. And then Bill said, well, we'll have to talk. And then later, the following day, Mzwakhe Ntlabati called. He said, man, I need to speak to you now. It's getting serious because the dean of that village called Jules and said to him, man, I hear that these young guys are angry. Can you please sort it out? These guys are fresh from 1976 riots. I don't want to see the village burning. And then the message came across, Bill said, you better go. And then I packed my things. And fair enough, I didn't tell my mother that I was expelled. I said to my mother, no, they are refurbishing the school, da, 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 da. So I said, now is the time, they're done, I'm going back. And then there was a party when I arrived, because I brought some beers, the students didn't have money, I brought some beers. So they said, hey, you saved the school. The school was going to burn. I said, no, guys, you don't have to do that. But yeah, I mean, that's something that no one knows, that I was expelled.
There was the many amazing people that one meets in this world and this field. I remember when Linda came to tell us that she had had a meeting with Reinhold Kassira, who was married to the late great Nobel novelist Nadine Gordimer. And I know he once said to Sam, I'm so angry, sit down, Sam. And Sam said, why? And he said, that gentleman who just left called me Mr. Gordimer. And but Rani was an extraordinary man, and we were so pleased and so proud. And I remember that other than in the Goodman Gallery, one of the only galleries I wanted to go to every show was to see what he came up with next. And Linda said, well, we're very, very fortunate because he wants us to take on these two people, William Kentridge and Sam and Nhlengethwa. I'm not sure yet what I'm going to do with them, but they've both got potential. And yeah, it worked out fairly well, I think we could say, for both of you. But the interesting thing is, looking at the notes and talking with both of you on the phone and in the courtyard here in the last couple of days, you've both done residencies at the Städel Museum in Frankfurt, although I don't even know whether you've discussed that between you. Yeah. You both had, I think, your very first solo shows at the Market Theatre. You both were part of exhibitions that traveled because of the anti-apartheid movement to the Museum of Modern Art in Oxford. Mm-hmm. And you may have come to your careers through very different trajectories and very different beginnings, but there have been an incredible number of coincidences in the stopping places and the high points along the way. And I think that for those of us who constitute your audience, and your viewership, and for those of us lucky enough perhaps to be your collectors and listen to some of the ideas that you've had, tonight is a privilege, but it's also been wonderful to watch what has happened with these two careers. So I think I'm going to ask for a final word. Is there something about the idea of the collaborations and the conversations that you might like to end off with?
I will end off with a wish for a continuation. There are many things to go further down into that we haven't had a chance for here. But this is a suggestion that we came up with a few years ago, and I'm pleased that it was before we had the centre, and I'm very happy that it's happening here in the centre.
Yeah, because I came with the idea when we turned 55. I said, William, it could be so relevant. Born 55 and we are 55. But because we're both busy in different ways, it couldn't happen. But better late than never.
Thank you.
Sometimes the less good idea is a really great one. Thanks. We're going to hear something from Belafonte and Makeba. And just to reiterate, as Bronwyn said, we do have to ask everybody now to give up your seats and to exit the space, as they need to make some changes for the next performance. But thank you all for your attention, and I hope it's been an interesting conversation. Thank you to Sam and to William.
Thank you. Thank you, Neil.
Babu Yangisiya, when you come back.